Revelation 12:11, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. Welcome to By the Word of Their Testimony, and here is your host, Etienne McClintock.
Dear listener, greetings and a warm welcome. Thank you for joining me on the program today. I'm delighted to have your company, and my special guest in the studio is Bruce Niyibitanga. Bruce, welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. It's great. I've met you through some of the work we've been doing to establish a new church plant and find people who have not heard the gospel yet and want to hear the gospel, the end time gospel for Jesus Christ. And I've been inspired by your enthusiasm and commitment to be part of this church plant group.
Praise God. Yeah, it's been a pleasure. Yeah.
Yeah.
Such a blessing being a part of the team.
Wonderful. Yeah, I've been so inspired. I'm one of the older guys in the team, and then we've got a lot of young guys and young ladies who are actually working on the program. We're actually going door to door. We are doing some small group stuff where we're meeting on a regular basis. And then on top of that, also, there's anything from cooking demonstrations to depression recovery programs and a number of other things that are being provided to the community to help people, you know, meet the needs of the community.
Definitely.
Now, your name, Bruce, obviously, is a name that you will find in Australia, no problem. But Niyibitanga, where does that come from?
My background is Burundian. And so Niyibitanga is a Burundian last name or name. And it means God provides.
Wow, so, that's nice.
Yeah.
So even in the Bible, you know, typically names have meaning and significance. They either present a character trait or, you know, a certain quality. And here we also see that beautiful meaning and significance in your surname.
Yeah, that's it.
So you were born in Burundi?
No, I was actually born in Tanzania, Africa.
Oh, okay.
But my parents are from Burundi. They fled from Burundi to Tanzania because of the ethnic wars that were happening there.
Wow.
Yeah, so they were. So I was born in Tanzania, Africa in 99.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay, well, that sort of gives you, everybody can now figure out roughly how old you are.
Yeah.
So you've done a couple of decades then, you know, you've hit 20, okay, fantastic. And the environment you were raised in, your parents, after they fled, were they in a safety camp, or were they working there and part of the typical Tanzanian establishment at the time?
They were working there as well in the refugee camp in Tanzania.
Okay.
And they were working there just to get a living. My dad was a security guard at the local hospital.
Mm.
And my mom was just tilling the land, tending to crops in the field.
Right, okay. Yeah. And was that more for your own personal well-being, or was there a little bit of sales involved as well?
She did both. We had a little store there in the refugee camp, and so that was personal well-being as well as also for the store.
For income. Okay. Yeah. So you grew up in that environment. There would have been a lot of people around.
But funnily enough, because I was only young at the time, I don't remember much about it.
Okay.
And I can only remember just some
glimpses,
highlights.
Yeah. Any family photos that go back then that might remind you what it was like?
Or? Yeah, I do have childhood photos.
Okay.
Yeah. The one I have is when I was 2-year-old. There's some when I was even like 9 months, but the ones I remember of is when I was 2 and, yeah.
Right, okay. So you can't remember if it was good, bad, tough, or otherwise, except for family stories.
I can't remember that much, you know.
Okay. So that's... You guys are in Tanzania?
Yep.
And then what happens is, what happened? Because if you're only young when you were at the camp and then you left, where did you go?
So we actually came to Australia in 2005. And so we actually lived in Adelaide for 5 years. And then after that, in just the end of 2010, we moved up to Queensland. And that's where we are today.
Queensland. Okay, so that's probably a much more conducive climate if you come from Tanzania.
Yeah.
Okay, wow. So your parents were able to come across as refugees, or how did they come across it?
They came as a refugee, immigrant, and it was through the UNHCR program.
Okay.
And we were able to get a visa to come to Australia.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Now, so you were around 6 years old when you came to Australia?
5 years old. Turn six, right. Yeah.
Now, as far as the influences in your life growing up, what were the influences like?
Growing up, I was born in a Christian home, Pentecostal home, and influences were kind of like, just because we are such a family-orientated culture, I guess. You being South African, I think you'd know this.
I know a little bit about that, I guess.
Yeah, so we're family-orientated, and because my family was a Pentecostal family, the influences were about scriptures and trying to maintain a Christian lifestyle. So in that sense, it was a good one. But then again, when I started school and started getting influenced by my friends, it wasn't the best experiences. I started kind of compromising my Christian faith and virtues.
Okay, so the school you attended, was that just a normal government school?
Or
was it, it was a secular school, basically. Yeah. Right, okay. And then you start being exposed to things you weren't being exposed to previously in an environment where your family obviously would have controlled what came in and went out.
Yeah.
And you would have had wholesome influences there.
Mm.
So how did that impact your life now, being exposed to how the other half live, so to speak?
Yeah, so I probably, thinking about it, it was probably around grade six when I moved to Queensland.
Mm.
And this was when my friends started influencing me a bit more than...
Okay, than when you were younger.
Yeah, than I was younger. And I remember actually one of my friends, the first thing that he told me after we became good friends, that is like, Bruce, you know what? The first thing I'm going to do to you or to change you is I'm going to get you swearing. That's the very...
Really?
That's the very first thing.
Okay, so you were known for having a pure language. You know, to curse or swear?
Yeah. So that's the first thing that this...
So this guy was on a mission?
Yeah, he was on a mission.
Oh, okay.
He was on a mission. And
and this was one of your best friends?
Yeah, and he was one of my best friends. And he got me into swearing, and later on he got me into all these things like girls and whatnot, have you, and
That was very different.
Yeah, very different.
Yeah. But unfortunately, we're all born with a fallen humanity, and it tends to gravitate to that probably far readily than it does to spiritual things, unless there's a spiritual influence there.
Definitely, yeah.
So when God's Holy Spirit's continuously working to counteract all the inherited tendencies we have, and then, of course, on top of that, you throw the cultivated tendencies in, it's an upward battle.
Yeah.
But we praise God that we're sin-abounded, grace does much more abound.
Amen.
So, yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, so you're this started around grade six. So what are you, about 12, 11, 12?
Around 12 years old, yeah.
12, okay.
12 years old, yeah.
Okay, so if they're successful in some ways, is there still a spiritual component to your life at this time?
This time, yes and no.
Okay.
So I still prayed and whatnot when I remembered. And generally, I would sometimes forget, you know, those moments as like you're really tired, you go into sleep and I'm on the bed and I'm telling myself I need to pray, and then just sleep gets me and I'm dead.
Right.
Asleep.
Or you just try and have a little prayer while you're hitting on the pillow and,
exactly.
And then fall asleep.
Yeah. Okay. So at this time, my prayer life or just studying the Bible in itself was not the greatest at all.
Okay. Yeah.
But I still counted myself to be a Christian. I still went to church on every Sunday and whatnot, but...
And your parents, did they notice any change at this time, or do they just think it's just part of, you know, growing up in Australia?
I don't think they noticed. I think they just thought it was just a little phase I was going through, going through teenagehood, and, you know.
Yes.
And so I was not rebellious, but also just, I was a quiet kid.
Oh, okay.
So I was a very quiet kid, and when my mom told me to like do dishes, for example, I would be very annoyed, and there'll be some reluctancy to obey her command in doing dishes and whatnot.
Okay. Where in the past you would have been more
available
to do it, and now it's just become more of a hassle than a pleasure. Okay, I understand.
Yeah.
So she started noticing a difference in attitude.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Okay. And now, is that just part of growing up, or is that just because of the influences in your life at the time?
I think that was just because of the influences, because all my siblings weren't like that, and they were probably more firm in spirituality probably than I was at the time.
So how many children in your family?
Back then or now?
Back then.
Back then we were, the fourth was probably on the way, so I was one of four.
One of four. So yeah. Are you somewhere in the middle? Or
no,
you're...
I'm the first.
You're the oldest?
Yeah, I'm the eldest, yeah.
Right, okay. So you're sort of leading by example in many respects, and then there's some influences there that are sort of detracting.
Yeah.
So your younger siblings are more conducive to helping.
Yeah.
And you're becoming a little bit less conducive to helping because it's interfering with what you want to do.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, I understand. Yeah. Okay, and your parents thought it might just be a phase. But, you know, some people feel that when you get older and people get into teenage years, that all teenagers just go through a phase. But what you said to me before is it was the influences in your life that weren't so good that created that phase.
Yeah.
That we don't necessarily have to have a bad phase, do we?
No, we don't. Yeah. Okay. And I believe, especially as Christian, Bible-believing Christians, I think when we look at Scripture, teenagers don't need to go through that phase.
Right.
And as long as parents, one, and the child themselves are wholly consecrated unto Scripture and to actually maintain a lifestyle that is according to Scripture, we don't need to go through that phase at all.
Sure.
Yeah.
And the Bible strongly encourages that family unity where the family are always together, they're worshiping together, they're working together.
Definitely.
And that the biggest influence is actually through the family and through Scripture.
Yeah.
You know, it's showing the people the beauty of the law of God, which is the moral principles that actually is there for our protection and our happiness.
Yeah.
And a lot of people actually misunderstand those principles, and then they talk about them as arbitrary.
Yeah.
But received through Christ and through the Holy Spirit, they're actually 10 promises of a wholesome living.
Amen.
Okay, so that's interesting that you raised that. So obviously subsequent to the four children, there's a few more children now?
Yeah, so right now I'm one of seven.
Wow.
So being the eldest.
That's a good biblical number.
Yeah, that's what I tell my parents that. That no more. Seven is a number of completion.
Yeah.
And yeah, so the youngest is 1.5 years, and so there's a great range, 1 to 19 years. So 18 years different from youngest to eldest.
Mm.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. It was fantastic to be part of a good-sized family.
Yeah.
My family on my dad's side, there were 8 children. My mum's side, there were 6 children, and they stopped at 2. I was the oldest, and then I've got a younger sister.
Yeah.
Always wanted to have a big family, but we didn't get there. And then, of course, my wife and myself have been married many years, but we've got no children.
Oh, okay.
So, it's fizzed with us.
Yeah.
But I do admire these stories of 7 children. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're a secular Christian? Can I call you that?
Because,
at the time we were talking about,
definitely.
So you've got these influences.
Yeah.
Take us further with the story. What happens through that part of your life?
Well, I think it got worse and worse in the sense that I was never rebellious at home or did any crazy things as in like go away from home or anything like that.
Mm.
I was very
there was
very
sort of element
careful.
Of respect.
Yeah, there was sort of an element of respect, and I praise God for that because I know for a fact that if God would have allowed me or just allowed me to go further than I did, I don't think I'll be a Christian at all.
Hmm.
And I remember I got highly into sport and a lot of rugby and a lot of...
As in rugby union?
Rugby league.
Rugby league, yeah. Okay.
And I got into basketball as well.
Hmm.
And I had a scholarship to go to high schools and schools for these sports, but I kept seeing God closing the doors. And
really?
The first time I had a scholarship to go to a certain high school, it was in Ipswich called Ipswich Boys Grammar.
Hmm.
And it was considered one of the best schools in Queensland at the time. And but in that very year, the year that I would have transitioned to high school with the scholarship, my dad is like, oh, I'm sorry, but we got to move to Logan. And so we moved from Ipswich to Logan, and that just nullified the scholarship to them. So I couldn't go to the high school. And I just kept seeing God doing that all my life. And now that I reflect back on it, that's when I realized that it was God. But at the time, I didn't realize it was God.
Okay, so were you disappointed when some of these
things? Yeah, definitely, okay. Definitely. I was very disappointed. And I love my sport.
Sure.
I love now. And so I thought my dad was being a hindrance to that.
Okay, right.
Yeah.
But you're saying in looking back now, it's on God's providence
that
he led the way he did.
Definitely, yeah.
So the outcome has actually been better in the long run.
Yeah.
Praise God. Okay.
Amen.
So you guys then moved to Logan.
Yep.
You have to develop new friends and friendships.
Yeah. So I went to Logan, went to a school called Maple Park State State School. So I would have been in grade 7 at this time, so not in high school just yet. But yeah, this was probably around when I was trying to change. And I remember this
change
was,
for the better?
Yeah, change for the better.
Okay, and change back.
Yeah, become an actual Christian. And and so we were still Pentecostal at this time. And however, I was reading my Bible and I was going to church and I was hearing sermons about young people being used by God, and I was really convicted about it.
Mm.
And I remember as a child, I would always, whenever I remember to pray, like I would pray, Lord, change me that I might change others. And
wow,
that was a prayer that I always prayed when I was a kid. And God has been faithful, and I believe that he did change me.
Mm.
And yeah.
And were you able to make good Christian friends at your church? You know, you attending.
I was attending I was actually attending two churches, and at this time, the reason
trying you searching for a double blessing.
Yeah, exactly. That was actually my mentality. So I remember I'd go to my family's church. So in the morning, I think they started around 9 o'clock in the morning, finished around 12 o'clock, and then I would actually run from our church to my auntie's church, which started around 1 o'clock.
Oh.
And so I would run, and in my mind, I thought I need to show God that I want to change and I want to be used by him.
Right.
And so this was kind of my mentality. So I would go to different churches, like as many places as possible.
And you enjoyed going to church.
Yeah, I enjoyed it and loved it. And yeah, and ever since after that, I wanted to share Christ.
Mm.
And at school, they started to see a difference, especially my friends. And I started preaching at school. And my friends.
How old are you now when you start preaching at school?
Probably 13. Yeah.
13. Wow.
I was just when I was transitioning into high school. Mm. And so from that time on, I stopped swearing. Like God really helped me to stop swearing.
Mm.
And I started preaching to sharing Christ and what God has done in my life with my friends, because they knew where I was at. They knew exactly how I was and the life that I was living. And they were so amazed as how I was able to change in that sense, like go from a worldly person into a God-fearing person, I guess, a Christian person. And yeah, it was such a blessing. But as you do, when you become a bit more spiritual and your friends are still in that worldly mindset,
you lose a lot of friends. Okay, I was going to ask you, you've lost a few friends.
Yeah.
And through the process, did you make some new friends?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And it was such a blessing, because when you gain friends that are that spiritual minded and that are individuals that actually are mission minded as well, it also builds your character and you want to be on that level that they are on as well.
Yes, certainly. So what was it that made you change? Was it an event? Was it the influence of someone? Was it just the scriptures? Was it the family unit? What was it that caused you to say, look, what the world is offering me is not what I want? I think God has got something better in mind for me. Can you sort of put that into words?
So like me personally, how I changed?
What caused that? What motivated you to change? Can you explain that a little bit? Or was it just the Lord speaking to your heart? Was it as simple as that?
I think, to be honest, I don't remember any sudden thing of like, oh, like the world is not giving me what I want, really.
Okay, so it wasn't an epiphany moment. It was something, was a gradual process within your mind and your heart.
I think because even when I was in the world, I still had this little voice or mindset that you need to change.
So the Spirit of God was always talking to you.
Yeah, it's very interesting, because even when I was still in the world, I still remembered to pray, like sometimes anyways. And and I would always say, Lord, like change me that I might change others, like I said. And this was still when I was in the world. But I think the more I went to church and I was listening to the sermons that were actually being preached, the more I was being felt convicted in changing.
Mm.
And I met a friend of mine called Jeffrey, and we were around, I was around 13, he was probably around 11 years old or so. And during this time, there was a sermon being preached by the pastor there. And he was preaching on Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
Right.
And And he was saying how there were young men in Babylon, and there were different men, and they were showing God's truth in the midst of a pagan country.
Yes.
And as I'm hearing this, I'm actually at the back playing on a Nintendo DS, to those who knows.
You're in the back of the church playing a Nintendo?
Yeah.
Oh.
I'm at the back playing on the Nintendo DS with my friend Jeffrey, and I'm hearing this sermon, and I'm feeling very convicted of, like, on what the pastor is preaching. And at the end,
so you were multitasking.
Yeah.
You were listening and playing at the time. Yeah. But there's enough of the sermon coming through that you are under conviction.
Yeah, yeah.
Praise
and
God.
At the end of the sermon, there was an appeal. And I told Jeff, like, oh, Jeff, let's go up. Let's go up. And he's like, okay, why not? And so we went up for prayer. And so I think that's what gave just made a ripple effect in my life, and it just kept on going, just that desire and hunger.
You were inspired by the story of young men, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and their devotion to God in a difficult environment, a pagan environment.
Yeah.
Wow, praise God. So that's the power of testimony.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so you're age of 13, and that's the catalyst that starts transforming and changing your life. That's one of the things that stands out, right, that sermon in particular.
Mm.
Okay, so you're preaching at school at times?
Yeah.
How's that received?
Well, it kept going and going. And as I went into, so I started preaching when I was like in grade 8, so when I first started in high school. And probably the highest amount of preaching that I've done in 1 year is probably in grade 10 and 11, I think. And during this time, I would hold Bible studies, and like at lunchtime, a second break, and this was when I was transitioning to become a Seventh-day Adventist. And
You were transitioning.
Yeah, yeah,
we're
becoming Seventh-day Adventist, and I was searching up the Seventh-day Adventist truth, and I was so impressed, and I was sharing this truth with the friends.
You're searching it on the online, in the internet, or how were you searching it?
This time we were already, you know Mark Woodman?
Yes, I've heard of Mark. Yeah, he's Mark, a South African.
Yeah, South African guy. Yeah,
he's passed away since, but yes.
Yeah, so we had his set of DVDs of prophecy, and these I would watch them, me and my dad, every single night, and they were so amazing. And I would learn and study these prophecies myself, and try and commit them to memory and share with my friends at school. And every second lunch break, we would take a Bible study class. But unfortunately, as the devil does, I actually got into trouble with teachers. I got called up one day to the principal's office and told him I wasn't allowed to preach. And I told him, look, I understand what you're saying, but I can't stop sharing Jesus. And I told him that, and I actually found myself preaching to the principal himself.
Oh, okay. You're right. He came to tell you to not preach, and you end up preaching to him.
Yeah, yeah. So but he didn't want to take it any further, so he just told me, Bruce, you got to stop. Because I wasn't a rebellious student at this time, so this is when God actually fully converted me.
Yes.
And so I wasn't a rebellious student or anything like that. So they were very surprised as to why I was actually denying to say, oh, I can't share Jesus or anything like that. And And as I do, like, I would actually pack little Bibles, the New Testament Bibles, and I would actually distribute them every lunchtime to students at school. And I would take secret Bible studies. And whenever, but the problem was that I would be sharing a Bible study with maybe a group of two people. And then all of a sudden, another people, like five people, just come and join. And sooner or later, like, the group has already become like a group of 40 people, and you're raising your voice in order to
so they can hear you.
Yeah, so they can hear you.
So and it's no longer a secret as you want it to be.
Yeah, no. So, then I'll see teachers who are on duty coming along and coming to check out what's going on.
Yeah.
And so I'll be like, oh, guys, I gotta go. And then I just give them the literature that I have and then just go off. And yeah, the rest is history.
Wow.
Yeah, so I was trying to go incognito.
Okay, understand. So, okay, you and your dad started watching these Mark Woodman videos, DVDs, whatever it is.
Yeah.
At this time, you're still Pentecostals?
Yep. At this time, we were transitioning to become Seventh-day Adventists.
Now, what caused you to start looking somewhere else if you're in the church and you're, Pentecostal?
Yeah.
Can you maybe talk us through that a little bit?
Yeah, so we actually, the way we became Adventists was through my pastor at the time in the Pentecostal church was taking a child from choir back home. And the child asked the pastors, like, oh, why do we worship on Sunday? And the pastor, as he does, as a normal Pentecostal pastor says, like, oh, we worship on Sunday because that's when we had victory over Satan and that's when Christ rose from the dead. And this is when we worship on Sunday.
Right.
Yeah, this is why we worship on Sunday, sir. And but this actually caused him to actually search a bit more in
this
scripture.
Is the person that asked the question from the pastor?
No, the pastor. Yeah,
he
caused the pastor to actually search a bit more as to why do we actually worship on Sunday.
Okay.
And, yeah. He,
so this is your church pastor?
Yeah, this is my church pastor, the Pentecostal church.
Pastor, yeah.
Yeah, so, and after a while, he actually searched for himself, and he came to understand about the Sabbath before us, but we didn't know. And every Saturday, as we called it at the time, we'd have prayer meetings. And
Was this a new prayer meeting that the pastor had set up, or always have them on Saturdays?
We always had it on Saturday.
Okay.
Yeah, so we—
Daytime, evening?
Daytime.
Okay.
Yeah, so around from 7 a.m. all the way to— sometimes we'll have all-day prayer meetings, 7 a.m. to all the way at night. And but this day, I think it was only a half day because of choir practice. And so he asked for a secret prayer request. He said, guys, I have a secret prayer request, and if God answers, I'll tell you what it is. And so we were praying for this secret prayer request, saying, Lord, if it is in accordance to your will, answer our pastor's prayer request. But we didn't know what the prayer request was.
Okay.
Yeah. So
this is obviously— this prayer request is part of your story and how you've gone from, you know, being a Pentecostal Christian to becoming a Seventh-day Adventist Christian.
Yep.
Well, dear listener, this is all we have time for the first half of the program. We're halfway through. And I have in the studio as my special guest sharing his testimony, Bruce Niyibitanga. And we're just going to take a short break here. And when we come back, we'll hear more or hear part two of his story.
Amen.
Amen.
In the Geoscience Research Institute Library, we just completed this dog skull display. The little chihuahua, the rather strange English bulldog, and the huge St. Bernard skull up here at the top are so different that if dug up by paleontologists, they'd probably be considered different species. Yet we know that these skulls came from the same species, Canis lupus familiaris. If there were only one pair of dogs on Noah's Ark, we'd expect that all the amazingly different dog breeds came from that ancestral pair, and this appears to be the case. All domestic dogs look as if they descended from grey wolves, and this grey wolf skull shows what natural selection does, maintaining organisms in an elegant state of efficiency. But we can see from domestic breeds that selection can create incredibly different dog breeds. On this side of the display, we have skulls from different species of wild dogs and foxes. Like domestic breeds, species in the genus Canis are usually capable of interbreeding and show evidence of descent from a single kind of ancient dog. Things are not so clear with the foxes. They have a different number of chromosomes than dogs. Maybe they didn't descend from the same ancestor as domestic dogs. There are lots of theories about this, but to me, the interesting thing is that the domestic breeds show more variation than wild dogs and foxes together. One thing seems fairly sure. Wolves appear to have been created with an incredible ability to vary in ways that anticipate different conditions in the wild, as well as the different requirements of humans who love dogs as I do.
Dear listener, thank you for staying with us on this program. My special guest in the studio is Bruce Niyibitanga, and he's sharing his testimony today. Now, Bruce, just before the break, you were telling us you belong to a Pentecostal church. Matter of fact, you're attending two churches. You've got the church in the morning, and then midday when it finishes, you race off to your aunt's church, and you go and attend the church in the afternoon there.
That's right, yeah.
But you have a pastor who was asked a simple question, why do we worship on Sunday? And then he starts doing further research and investigation in regards to this. And at a Saturday prayer meeting, which was a regular prayer meeting you had every Saturday morning, he then has a special prayer request. doesn't tell you what it is. He said it's a private, personal one, and if the Lord answers, then he'll share it with you.
Yep.
Okay, so that's where we left the story. Keep on going.
All right, yeah. So we were praying for this prayer request as just didn't think much of it, to be honest with you. We're just praying it for it every Saturday prayer meeting and whenever we remembered when we got home or anything like that. But we didn't take notice or see it to be a big deal or anything like that.
Sure.
Because it wasn't the first time someone had a personal secret prayer request. Mm. So we just thought it was just a prayer request like any other, I guess. And however, we were praying for this prayer request for like 2 years, for 2 years before we actually came to know what the prayer request was.
2 years. So yeah. He never tells you what this prayer request is. It's just a secret prayer request.
Yep.
And every week when you come together, that's on the agenda for prayer.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So we were praying for this for 2 years. So one day there's a group of people and in the same prayer meeting, on the Saturday. And my dad comes up and he says, guys, I've been researching about the Sabbath. And we actually worship on the wrong day.
He says that at the prayer meeting
with the pastor there. And he says that, the Sabbath is actually on Saturday and it was changed from Saturday to Sunday.
Mm.
And another person in the same prayer meeting, someone said, at uni, someone's been telling me that the Sabbath was actually changed by the Roman Catholic Church from Saturday to Sunday.
Yes.
And again, another person rose and said, my husband is a Seventh-day Adventist and he's always been telling me that we worship on the wrong day.
And this all comes out all of a sudden.
Yeah, it comes out all of a sudden, and it's just amazing. For me as a kid, I was around maybe 13 at the time. This was when I was coming out of the world and also hearing about this message. And so I'm just like, what is this thing? Like, what is this Sabbath thing? And so I didn't take much of it. But then my pastor was like, guys, I'm ready to tell you what I asked you to pray for 2 years ago.
Wow.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. And now what was his secret prayer request?
And so he actually prayed because he had already understood when the Sabbath was.
Mm.
And so his prayer was actually that God may work through other individuals to actually bring this Sabbath topic in order for the whole church to see the importance of the Sabbath. And his prayer was that the whole church may actually come to an understanding about the Sabbath truth.
Mm.
And it was April 19th. My sister's birthday, that was our very first Sabbath of 2014.
Okay.
Yeah, so this was our very first Sabbath, and as a whole church, we became Seventh-day Adventists.
The whole church converted to keeping the Sabbath.
Yeah, so on the 27th of September, same year, 2014, we were baptized as a whole church at the South Queensland Big Camp. Yeah.
Praise God.
Amen. Yeah.
That is momentous when the whole church...
Yeah.
Comes across like that. So the pastor and everybody.
Yep, the pastor and everyone. I think there was only one family that didn't want to become Seventh-day Adventist or transition on to keeping the Sabbath.
Yeah.
But other than that, the whole church just took on the Sabbath message. It was amazing.
So leading up to that, did you have because obviously you had worship services on Saturday and on Sunday.
Yep.
Did you keep on doing that? And when did you stop the Sunday services or did you keep on using those as well?
And so what would happen is because we started to see the importance of the Sabbath.
Mm.
And so we said, of April 19th, will be the first Sabbath and we'll stop worshiping on Sunday.
Right.
And Sunday was just like any other day, a work day for us.
Mm.
But because we always wanted also to have prayer meetings and fasting prayer days, so because it normally would have been on the Saturday.
Yes.
So we said, okay, we'll just make Sunday the day where we have a prayer meeting or a fasting prayer.
Mm.
And so Sunday became the day where we have prayer meetings or...
So you just swapped the days basically.
Yeah, basically.
We convicted on the scriptures and then also everybody putting in how the Holy Spirit has been leading them through experience or study.
Yeah.
That's the Seventh-day Sabbath is the true day that God has set aside for worship.
Yeah, definitely. And I tell you, actually, there was a spiritual battle going on before even we became Adventists.
Mm.
And at the time, I didn't understand it personally. Okay. And I don't know if we have time for me to share that bit of the testimony.
Sure, yeah, by all means.
So it was probably around 2013.
Yeah.
So I was still 12 years old at this time.
Mm.
So it was early 2013. And at this time, we went to, we were still Pentecostal then.
Mm.
And so I went to a camp meeting, a youth camp meeting invited by my auntie's church.
Okay.
And so I went with them, and it was called Outbreak Camp.
Mm.
And so we went out. It was in Mount Tambourine in Queensland, if anyone knows where that is.
Yes, I do.
Yeah. So we went there, and it was a beautiful place, beautiful scenery and whatnot. Didn't think much of it. And there was hall rooms and where we'd meet up for prayer and for sermons and whatnot. And I didn't think much of it. I was actually really excited being a kid. And this was the time when I was coming out of the world and all that. And so I was like, okay, like this is amazing. And it's going to be spirit filled and all that. And there's going to be a lot of young people, which is great. And so we arrived there around about 12 in the afternoon.
Mm.
And we had our lunch and we came together, reconvened together as a group, and we had prayer. And the day wasn't too long, so we just had evening prayer and worship, and we went to sleep. So it was in the morning of the second day that we came together as a youth group from my auntie's church.
Yes.
And one of my friends, actually, one of my friends and a family friend came up to me and asked me, like, Bruce, can you pray for me? I'm like, oh, yeah, why not? That's all right. And so as they do in Pentecostal churches, I put my hand on her forehead and I started to pray. And I said, in the name of Jesus. And she started shaking profusely and she fell down. And at this point, I didn't think much of it because you see this all the time in the Pentecostal churches, people being slain in the spirit, term it. And so I didn't think much of it. But it was when I opened my eyes that it didn't seem right.
Okay, so something was different.
Was different. And I opened my eyes and her eyes were actually rolled backward. And she was shaking beyond comprehension. And she actually got up and her voice was really deep. Like it went from a girl's voice into a really deep man's voice. And and I was like, this is not normal. And this can't be the Spirit of God. And she actually said, Bruce, I want to kill you. Like, I want to kill
you. Not the Spirit of God, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, Bruce, I want to kill you and take you to hell. And being 12 years old, I'm like, no, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. I couldn't even say anything.
Mm.
And it said that I want to kill you and take you to hell because God wants to change you. And I didn't understand this at the time. And so I'm like, no, in the name of Jesus. And she's actually coming forward, and I say in the name of Jesus, and she falls down again. Anyways, another group of youth and my aunties come along and help me out. And it wasn't until an hour later that the demon actually left her.
Wow.
And, but when it left, it actually said, I'll be back.
Wow.
So that was kind of scary for me. And that was the very first time I had seen a demon possession or some spiritual manifestation like that.
Right.
And so
you've seen spiritual manifestations before in a Pentecostal church, but not a demonic one to that extent. Okay,
yeah.
right.
So I was really scared during that day, like, and just as you would as a 12-year-old seeing that and all these things. And actually, one thing I forgot, the demon actually said that I want to kill you, your mom, and your dad, and your grandfather, and your grandmother. And those are the people that it named. And the people that I was with asked, why do you want to kill them? And it said, because God wants to change them. And that's why I was confused. I'm like, okay, but my grandfather, he was a pastor in the church. And so why do you want to kill him? He's already a spiritual person. Like, why does God want to change him?
Mm.
He's already a spiritual person. So I was very confused as to what this meant.
What that meant.
Yeah, so
so you're thinking, look, they're already there. You're too late.
Yeah. Exactly, yeah.
Not knowing that there's more to come.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because truth is progressive, isn't it? Yeah. We believe that, yeah.
Definitely. And
the relationship with the Lord is because of that. Yeah,
definitely. And this is when it left, and I was just so scared and confused. And as I said, it said, I'll be back. And I'm like, oh, no, like, I hope it doesn't come back. I hope it's just
it wasn't
lying.
A pleasant experience. You don't want to repeat it.
Yeah, no. And,
understand.
But when the demon left her, my friend was just, didn't know what was going on. She was like, why are you guys standing over me? So she didn't realize what was actually happening.
Because she wasn't conscious, really.
No, yeah.
Okay.
So deep in the back of my mind, I'm just like, you nearly killed us. That's what was going on. And but she didn't actually realize. And so because of that, I didn't want to separate myself from her, even though I was so scared. And I didn't want to be with her just in case it would happen again.
Yes.
And so I didn't want to separate myself from her because she didn't know what was going on. And she was a family friend. And so during we came back, so this skipped the whole day, 9 o'clock at night, the same day. We came together in order to pray just before we go to sleep, and I was sitting next to her and my auntie, and I started to see her hand shake, and I'm like, oh no, I think this is starting again.
Yeah.
And I started to see her eyes roll back, and I'm like, nope. And I get up and I go the other side of the room because I was scared and I don't know what was going on. And it started again. And her voice changed again. And she's just started like screaming and saying all these things. And yeah. And they actually asked what demon or what spirit is it? And it said that it was the spirit of sexual immorality, the spirit of lying, the spirit of lust and all these things. And they asked, how many are you? And it said that it was over 25 demons inside of her.
Wow.
And so automatically from reading my scripture, and like I remembered the man with legion, called Legion.
Yes, yes.
And because there were many, and indeed there were many. And so we were praying all night. And around 12 o'clock, 3 hours later, from 9 o'clock to 12, we asked, like, how many are you now? And it's like, oh, we're only 12. With 12 demons, and we're like, and I'm just thinking, like, 12? Like, we've been praying for 3 hours, and, like, only 13 have come out. And so I was just really scared at this time. And actually, it didn't finish until 6:30 in the morning.
Wow.
6:30 in the
morning. So this lady is about the same age as you, this young lady?
Yeah, same. She's actually older than me by a couple years.
Okay.
Yeah. But we're kind of the same age, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it was a scary experience.
Yeah, definitely.
It wasn't until we became Adventists that I actually understood why it wanted to kill me and my mom, my dad, and my grandparents. Because the very people that it named were the very people that became Adventists.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is
so
powerful.
Because the demon actually didn't name my aunties.
Mm.
It didn't name my, or anyone like, so my aunties, my cousins, or anything like that. It just named my mom, my dad, and my grandfather and my grandmother. And these were the very people that became Adventists. Not to say that my aunties won't become Adventists. I'm praying for them.
Sure.
For them to become Adventists. But I started to see that there is a spiritual warfare in the Seventh-day Adventist truth. And we're being given a special message. And
yes.
For Adventists listening right now, this message is a powerful message, and Satan doesn't like that message.
Mm.
But it's sad sometimes we just take it for granted, the truth.
We've become so familiar with it. Yeah,
yeah.
That is so true.
Mm.
I was at a prayer conference. I think you were at the prayer conference as well. And a young man got up the front there and said, listen, when you listen to the messages, even if you've heard it before, listen to it as if you're hearing it for the first time.
Yeah.
I thought, well, that's a strange request to do. I said, but I don't even know if I can do that. I'll try.
Yeah.
And as I'm listening to the messages, I'm going, wow, this is profound. I've heard some of this before, but I'm actually listening to it with new ears and new eyes.
Yeah.
And what God has given His church, His last day church, is remarkable.
Yeah.
It is a very powerful message. And we need to be revived into regards to the incredible gift that God has given us that we need to share with other people.
Amen.
Mm. Yeah. It's all to do with what's lying ahead.
Mm.
There's a crisis coming on the world, and the only way that anyone will be survived is if they are hidden in the pavilion of God in the shadow of the Almighty.
Amen.
And we need to be sealed so that we can go through that time, because a destroying angel is coming. Just like when Israel left Egypt, there was a destroying angel that killed all the firstborn. The only ones that weren't destroyed are those who were covered under the blood of the Lamb on the doorpost. Those firstborns were passed over. That's where the word Passover comes from.
Yeah.
And such in the same way, God will pass over those who have been sealed by him, mm. who live up to the truth and a knowledge of a relationship with Christ that many do not yet possess.
Yes.
And we read about this in Revelation chapter 7, where the angels are to let loose the winds of strife that are going to blow on the earth.
Mm.
And then another angel ascends from the east, ascends yes. from the east, and it says, do not let loose the winds until all God's servants are sealed. So there are servants that are not sealed yet.
Yes.
And God has given a sealing message to his people, the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Yeah,
absolutely. And Satan wants everybody to be destroyed. So if he can keep people from receiving that message and hearing it and being sealed intellectually and spiritually into the truth of Christ so they cannot be moved, then he knows that he can have them on their side. He wants to destroy. And you were saying that this demon-possessed lady was saying that she was going to kill you guys.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then Jesus made that statement in John chapter 8, verse 44. He said, you are your father, the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning.
Mm.
The fact that she wanted to kill you guys just demonstrated what the spirit was.
Definitely.
So yeah. I hope this poor lady, this young lady, stayed delivered.
Yeah, yeah.
Stayed free from it. Praise, yeah. praise God.
Mm.
Mm. Well, that's very powerful, Bruce.
Amen.
Yeah. So this is as you are becoming Seventh-day Adventist Christians now.
Yep. Yeah.
That this happened to you.
Yeah.
And you didn't understand what was meant by those statements, God is looking to change you?
Yeah, no, I didn't understand what those statements were. And I just thought it was like me personally, that God wanted to change me. And because remember, my prayer was like, God, change me that I might change others.
Others, yes.
And so I thought it was this sense that, God wants to change me so that I may change others. And Satan is not happy with that.
Right.
And so I didn't really comprehend or understand.
You didn't know how far God was taking this changing
exactly.
component.
Yeah.
Okay. Praise the Lord.
Mm.
So, okay, the church becomes, you are all baptized.
Yep.
And you start up a new congregation or do you join an existing congregation?
So because the language barrier, we started a new church in the Seventh-day Adventist
Church. What do you speak in your church?
Kirundi.
Kirundi.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's where we speak. And it became easier for us and for church members that didn't understand the language.
Mm.
And yeah, it was such a blessing.
Wonderful. Yeah. Praise the Lord. And you're still at school at the time?
Yes, I was still at school at the time, yeah.
And still sharing the gospel with the people?
Yeah, definitely.
And does your gospel take on a slightly different component now, aspect in regards to the truths you're sharing?
Yeah, definitely. Because I was starting to share the prophecies with students there I was studying with Mormon. The school that we were going to was a very highly Mormon school, like a lot of Samoan students that were Mormon and other Sunday-keeping churches.
So it's a government school, but there's a lot of Christians in the school.
Yeah, it was a government school, but there was a lot of Christians there.
Mm.
And so I was able to share the truths in which I was learning in the Adventist church with these individuals. And just it was such a blessing being able to know the answers of like the prophecies of Revelation and Daniel, because when I was in Sunday, we read the book of Revelation and the book of Daniel, and we take it literal. So when we read of Revelation 13 of a beast that's rising out of the sea, we take that literal.
Okay.
And I remember being very afraid of reading even the book of Revelation and being afraid of the end times because of what Revelation tells us about a beast coming onto the earth. And I was always told that this represented a beast that would come up and it would ask you in the end times that if you believe in Jesus and if you say yes, it would chop off your finger or whatever.
And very literal interpretation.
Yeah, and the more you kept saying yes, it would just keep chopping until your whole body is gone. And but if you say that you don't believe in Jesus once, it's able to recreate your body again, and then you have the mark of the beast, apparently.
Wow, okay. Quite a different interpretation.
Yeah.
Where we believe, obviously, that Scripture interprets Scripture. And Daniel chapter 7 tells us that beasts represent kingdoms.
Kingdoms, yeah, that's it.
Yeah, wow. And then, of course, Revelation chapter 1 tells us that everything that was sent through from the Father to Jesus, which he gave to his servant John, was signified.
Symbols. Yeah.
Symbols, yeah. That's right.
Yeah.
Okay, so you've obviously learned a lot, and obviously you, when the opportunity arises, you still share that with people.
Yeah, definitely.
You're no longer in high school. I think you're a little bit older than that now. So.
No, yeah. So I finished school 2 years ago.
Okay.
Finished in 2017.
So what have you been doing subsequent to that?
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's a good question. So I had a scholarship actually to go to university.
Oh.
And I was, to anyone that knows the University of Queensland, that was the uni that I had a scholarship for. And I was actually studying engineering last year. Right. And so I was studying a Bachelor of Engineering with honors. And but I always had in the back of my mind that I wanted to do God's work full time.
Mm.
And while I was in high school, especially grade 12, I read this quotation in Testimonies for the Church, Volume 7, page 62,
yes,
where it says that the time has come when all church members are to take up the medical missionary work. And so my mind was like, Lord, I want to do medical missionary. And but I just didn't know how to do it or where to get the money from in order to study medical missionary. But I always wanted to do that work. And at this time, I was also canvassing. I got into the canvassing work. And through Jumpstart, anyone who knows Andrew Kaczynski.
Yes.
Yeah, so I was...
His brother Paul Kaczynski used to run the radio station here, yes.
Yeah, so I was canvassing with them. And so I'm like...
Canvassing is going door-to-door selling books.
Yeah, door-to-door, yes. Cool porter work, yeah.
Yeah.
And so I was very convicted and like, okay, you know what? I really don't want to do university, but they were paying me in order to study. So I wasn't actually paying anything. They were paying me in order to study whatever I wanted to do, and at the time it was engineering.
Mm.
And when I told my parents my ideas of stopping to study, they weren't too happy about it, but sure. They weren't negative either because they always were very supportive in doing God's work.
Mm.
They were just weren't sure if this was the right way to go. My grandparents, on the other hand, wanted me to study. And I didn't blame them for that because coming from a poor-stricken family, you know, and coming from Africa, you have an opportunity to make a name for yourself and be educated. So it's, I guess it's the right thing to do and to study, I guess.
Mm.
And so they wanted me to study. And so I kind of took that on board and did study for a year. I was in university studying, but... That was really pushing into my devotional time and my prayer life. I was coming home from uni just studying from, like, I'd catch a train at 1 in the morning, and I would get home, like, around 3 in the morning and then get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, and then by 7 o'clock go back to uni and repeat again. And so it was very hard for me to have a proper prayer life and Bible studies that I normally used to do.
You're hardly getting enough sleep.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I'm like, no, Lord, I just want to do your work full time. So I stopped university and I was canvassing full time. And I met the Eastward guys, Eastward Missions, which we're doing a church plant with.
Yes.
And they invited me to a canvassing outreach that was happening in Melbourne.
Mm.
And I'm like, oh, okay, yeah, I'll come down. And it was during December that I went down. I went down, was canvassing, and I was only meant to be there for just a week and then go back home. But I was speaking to a brother called Tim. And he invited me, like, oh, Bruce, we're doing a outreach in Phillip Island. Did you want to come? I'm like, oh, I've already booked a two-way flight. So, like, I don't know if I want to cancel that flight. And I'm like, oh, you know what? I'll do it. I'll cancel it. And went to Phillip Island, canvassed there for 2 weeks, I think it was. And then they invited me also to a church plant, which we, you know, as you're part of. And
yes.
Down at Lizaro. And I'm like, oh, God is opening doors, so I'm like, oh, okay, why not?
Mm.
And so came down, and so from just 1 week meant to be in Melbourne, I was actually down south for a good 3 months.
Wow.
And my dad at this time was back in Africa.
Mm.
He went in Africa in October, and so when I came down, I hadn't seen him, and he came back in January. So I hadn't seen my dad for nearly 6 months at the time. And so I went back home in order to say hi and tell them what's going on, and then just came back again.
Mm.
And yeah, so God's really been blessing. So just to answer your question in short, okay. I've been Bible working and canvassing full time.
Praise the Lord. Yeah, and we know you've made some many wonderful contacts already and some people are already doing Bible studies with, although we only started a matter of months ago.
Yeah, yes. Yeah.
So praise God for that, and I've really enjoyed you sharing your testimony, how the Lord has led you. But it just shows the importance of family influences. Mm. You know, from a young age, your family were Christians. They were spiritual Pentecostal Christians.
Yep.
And Bible reading and Bible study and prayer meeting was part of how you were brought up.
Yes.
Then there were some secular influences for a while. And it's interesting, even for children who are raised in a good Christian family, how easy we can get distracted because our natural human tendencies are to run down those channels.
Yeah.
You know, because we are egocentric and it's all about self-indulgence in many aspects, you know, and self-expression.
Yep.
But the Lord somehow is able to bring you back. Mm. And we praise God for your encouraging testimony. Dear listener, we are just going to take a break here. My special guest is Bruce Niyibitanga. We'll just take a short break, share our contact details, and we'll be right back after this. Stay tuned.
Thank you for joining us on By the Word of Their Testimony. If you would like more information about today's program, or if you have any questions, please contact 3ABN Australia Radio by phoning 02-4973-3456. Or you can send an email to radio@3abnaustralia.org.au. You can also contact us on our 3ABN Australia Radio Facebook page. We look forward to hearing from you.
Dear listener, just as we wrap up this program, my special guest in the studio is Bruce Niyibitanga. He's been sharing his testimony. And Bruce, just in the last couple of minutes we have, can you just maybe share some words of encouragement and hope for those who are listening today?
Yeah, I especially want to talk to the young people. Mm. The Bible says in the book of Psalms 127, verse 4, saying, as an arrow is in the hand of a mighty man, so are the children of the youth. And so the Bible shows us that young people or the youth are a weapon in God's hand. And the devil knows this, and a lot of the times we see that a lot of things that come in from the world are to distract young people.
Yes.
Because God and the devil knows that if they have young people, well, they have the whole world.
Mm.
And so I encourage young people to really have a personal experience with Christ.
Yes.
And just really seek, because Christ is there knocking at the doors, mm, as Revelation 3 verse 20 tells us.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the Bible tells us, taste and see that the Lord is good. You
Amen.
Know? Don't listen to the propaganda of the enemy, because
yep,
what happens is God is the most misrepresented person, mm, being on this planet.
Definitely.
And Satan has used all his propaganda to misrepresent him through lies and deceit.
Yeah.
And by tasting, you will actually come to taste the truth, mm, which is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The way, the truth, and the life.
Amen.
So, Bruce, thank you so much for sharing your testimony. Thank you for the encouragement you are to old and young.
Thank you.
I've heard you pray. I haven't heard you preach yet, but I look forward to hearing you preach one day.
Amen. Yeah.
And I can just tell by your prayer that you had a connection with God, and I could tell that the Spirit of God's working in your life.
Praise
so
God.
So that's been an encouragement to me.
Yeah.
I'm just a little bit older than you, but I know it'll be an encouragement to old and young.
Amen.
And dear listener, we just pray that God will continue to work in your life as well, that he will work in your life to will and to do according to his good pleasure. Because by nature, we are egocentric. We are so contrary to God's principles of love, the Ten Commandments, and also to the principles that we see revealed in the life of Jesus. But by beholding Jesus, we also can become changed and we can be transformed by the renewing of our minds. More than that, God is also able to recreate. The psalmist David, King David, says, create in me a clean heart, O God. So there's creation, which is instantaneous. So we pray that you would cleave to God, you would look to God, and you would taste and see how good he really is. Until next time, God bless.
You've been listening to a production of 3ABN Australia Radio.